Hello, hello, hello.
I'm Rangru.
And I'm Sadoz.
And we are doing a 4v4 on Korea Rocks. So, on Team 1, we have Jack Spartan, Lord 13, Master of Cybertron, and Command Fiss.
Yep, and for Team 2, for Pact, we've got Fly on Ice, Gray, Orlando Bloom, and Baron Smash. Mm-hmm. Pretty good names.
Indeed they are. So, Korea Rocks, a pretty open map. We have a river going down the mid, and it's really good for lots of ATGM play.
Yeah, it's interesting, Mac. I mean, I'd really like it if you could buy some patrol boats, because those canals seem pretty useful for that.
Yeah, really would take advantage if you could get like a few little patrol boats down the riverbeds, because they're in perfect position to just go right across the map.
Yeah, truly.
Mm-hmm. So, if we see from Redfall in Shell, you got a few MI8s, a little bit, that's quite a lot of MI8s with an MI24. Seems going to be a bit of a helicopter rush. Blue 4, that's you taking their time deploying units.
Yeah, we've got a T-64 BVI, two of them from Fly and Ice, which is pretty good. That's a pretty good tank. It's unlike most other pack tanks that are high points, it doesn't have an ATGM, but it's got a really good main gun.
And it has great armor as well, and it's a really reasonable price tank. It's probably one of the best just tanky tanks that Red 4 do get, or the USSR get.
Can we do a quick timestamp?
Timestamp? 150.
Yeah,
thanks. Okay, we're all good, we're all synced up. That is A-OK.
I am at 207.
Okay.
Yep, good enough. You're seeing a lot of units on the south from what's his name? Lord 13. Mm-hmm. You see a little strike force.
Yeah, it seems like he is playing a French deck. A lot of different types of French tanks, AMXs, Leclercs, Harpoons, B2s, bloody everything.
It's interesting because he's gone. I immediately assumed he would have a lot of like light tanks for a quick strike force, but with the Leclercs, that's you kind of have to protect those because you just got two max, so you can't just throw them away.
Yeah, it's actually bringing some Rolands and Mistrals, but it seems like he's just spending his whole money on that little platoon mechanized armored tank force, to be moving up. And it's kind of a good idea because it's a very open terrain map, so infantry only do Rolands in a few town areas.
Yeah, I've seen the pact one Akula. In the south, I love Akulas. They're such a great unit to bring on at the start, especially if you can keep them alive. They're pretty aggressive with their tanks. They got T-64 BVIs, they got T-72 BIs, so they've gone for their whole let's have good main guns and not to worry about ATGMs at the moment.
It seems
North, they're pretty passive.
Yeah, north, it's not too much. There's a bunch of infantry. Usually Red 4 like to capture that town just north of Foxtrot, because it kind of stops NATO or Blue 4 from going around the flank and doing any nasty, sneaky, peaky business.
Yeah, and we got a couple of Abrams from NATO in the north, and they're supported by a bunch of Sheridans, so that could be interesting.
Yeah.
Sheridans are an interesting tank.
So at the start, we have two Phantom Interceptors coming out from Blue 4 and an F-16 block for good luck, and one MiG-29 for Red 4. So Blue 4 getting quite a few Interceptors, actually, right off the bat.
Yeah, that is an expensive push with planes. It's surprising. There's a lot of expensive planes, but they seem to have a lot of ground forces at the same time.
They're doing a good job mixing it up. So Blue 4 are actually going to be doing a helicopter rush into the town north of Foxtrot. Some Bus Rangers, some Chinooks, and Akira for good luck.
Now, if you see, PAC really wants to go for Bravo. They've got their planes, their helis moving towards it, and they've got a signal flare.
Yeah, just flying right over.
Not sure where NATO's going with their helis.
Yeah, I think he's just trying to make a beeline to Alpha with those HKPs and Bells. But they are getting spotted by the Akula, and the Akula does have those nasty igles and our goodbye little helicopters.
Things are pretty furious up north. You're seeing a bunch of infantry on tank and ATGM fire.
Oh yeah, Blue 4 really have moved up into the valley of Mylands and Moors, doing some long-range ATGM roars. But they are out in the open and spotted and really clumped up. Just one good bomb, and they're all blown up to smithereens.
I think there's a bit of miscommunication happening, because if you see what happened, one of the NATO players, what his name is, Master Cybertron, whatever it is, has moved up really far.
Transformers.
And Jack Spartan's a bit too far back. His stuff is only coming up now, and it's all separated. Like, he's got Abrams separated on different parts of Sheridan. Mm-hmm. And one Abrams even stuck in the mud. It's detracted.
Oh, yeah. That's not good timing at all. But yeah, Sheridan's are starting to move up and be firing that ATGMs at long range. The Sheridan ATGM is pretty mediocre at best. It won't really put too much of a scratch on a T-72, but those BMP-2s will definitely feel the wrath. No, 1,000 kilogram bombs right on the infantry.
And if you look now at India, PACT is starting to pull back. They realize they're getting beaten. NATO's got the forest cover with the Lycrex, and they're doing a ton of damage to PACT.
Yeah, and they're going to be falling back across the river. Those Leclerc's in a perfect position, and Rail, the Leclerc is an absolutely stunning tank with very fast fire rate for a gun, 10 rounds a minute, where most other tank guns only have like 8 or 7.
Yeah.
So yeah, just being able to stop that push is quite nice, and they did get quite a few kills as well. So, hat right, quite well for them, and that's going to stop Redfall from moving out the bottom part, or the mid part of the map.
It's interesting, I think this Master Cybertron guy is actually playing Australia, because he's got SASR, and he had LAV recon vehicles, and I think I even saw some Australian planes.
Yeah, you don't really see national decks too much from a lot of players, as coalitions are kind of generally seem as the better type of deck to get, because you get a lot more units and you still get the prototypes, and all you really need are the prototypes.
Yeah.
So Redfall are going to have control over the Foxtrot Valley, bringing out some more tank reinforcements, and Blueforce sort of just regaining their forces into Juliet.
Overall, it looks pretty even. I mean, they took Bravo, but they also didn't take India. But at the same time, India's worth more points.
Yeah, indeed, indeed. But having Bravo will allow Redfall to gain the plus one tick on the enemy team, so they can really just play defensive the entire game if they want to. It's going to be all up to Bluefall to make the push.
And, in this map, you see, even in Bravo, there's actually quite a bit of distance in the back, so you could actually send something around there, and they've got no recon to stop any kind of helicopter push in the south.
Yeah, you could kind of go around at little right on the edge of the map and try to go around if you don't get spotted by recon. A bit of a risky maneuver, I have to say.
A lot of phantoms out doing their patrols.
Pretty. I think it's the Australian Phantom Interceptor. Pretty decent interceptor. It's like 120 points. Pretty cheap. Has okay ECM and all that rubbish. And it's pretty bog standard.
I think it's interesting to look at what people have taken. I don't know if you remember this, but in Alien Battle, there was that pretty significant change in terms of maps and supply. Like, they completely changed the way supply worked.
Reducing
the number of supply trucks you could buy, making fobs cheaper, increasing the supply fobs carry, and reducing the number of spawn zones. And I think that changed the metagame, because it forced people to use supply and think about supply in a way they didn't before. Go ahead.
No, sorry. As before, supply, when you get a supply truck, you'd empty out. It's like, okay, you can go off to your death now. I don't really care about you. But now you kind of have to keep your supply alive, because it's pretty valuable.
Truly. And I think you even notice that with the number of fobs players bring. Like, if you look at the here, NATO's actually got 3 fobs, whereas PACT has got 2. And the fact that they're still taking fobs at 75 points at the start, spending on a fob, is pretty important to me, because in the past, in Airline Battle, when it first came out, I would never have done that. And in Red Dragon, I find, and in Airline Battle after the patch, I took a fob every time, because you didn't quite know how long a game was going to last, but it was worth bringing on a fob.
Yeah, it's always just good for extra supply. It's pretty cheap, like 75 points for like 16,000 supply. Very much worth your bang for your buck. Also, just to take a note, in a Foxtrot, you have a bunch of SU-76s, a really archaic Road War II tank destroyer, just moving right into the line of the Sheridan fire, even bringing out an A4 or Skyhawk of ATGMs to try and knock a few of them out. Pretty suicidal move.
Yeah. And what I'm likely seeing is a Nighthawk. Let's see what's going to hit up north.
Oh yeah, I see that Nighthawk is locked onto its prey. I think it's going to get the SU-76. No, he's flying right over. And it is gonna try hit. Oh no, yes, yeah, gonna get the SUs. Using a lot of our units to kill these very cheap tanks, like a 10 points each, those tank destroyers. So they're very expendable.
Now, if you see, if you look at Charlie, you'll see an Akula that hasn't landed and isn't resupplying, and that happens to me all the time. I'll use my Akula, send them back, want them to get resupplied, but I'll forget to click land.
Mm-hmm.
That I kind of wish there was some kind of quick option that if you right click on a fob with a chopper, the chopper will automatically go back and supply itself.
It does, yeah.
Does that do it?
If you select a helicopter, right click an FOB, it will automatically land and resupply to max. And then you can shift click it afterwards to go back to the front lines. It's a really good tip for anyone who doesn't know. If you have a helicopter or a like a vehicle, select a vehicle, right click the FOB, the actual FOB logo, and then once you did that, select a vehicle again, do shift click and left click where you wanted to go back to the battlefield, and it would just resupply and come back easy peasy, like not much micromanagement involved.
Oh, that's really useful. That's something I'll be able to use from now on.
Also, in Foxtrot, we have another tank push coming up. Some pretty cheap T-62s versus a bunch of Abrams. And we actually have some mortars in the back, giving some good suppressive fire. Stunning them up a wee bit. And I think it's this whole little valley choke point here is going to be the main center of tank battles. Because both sides really wanting to move into either Foxtrot or Juliet.
I think it'd be smart if they started pushing up just north of Foxtrot, because you go around that hill, and I think they do a lot better.
Mm-hmm. Just go around the flank and head right into the side, because the northern part of Juliet is pretty lightly defended. You would have a lot of push coming up, some RBSs and STRFs.
I mean, if you attack from two positions, they need to split up their forces and you just do a lot better.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think they really want to try and do is capture that town, just the town just north of Foxtrot, with a bunch of infantry. They keep trying to crush this mountain over here, but on the other side of that mountain, there's a lot of nasty stuff. There's BMPs, MI4s, T-62s, and even the mods directly in the town are really going to make your day a living hell if you try to go over that little hill mountain.
And we see the arty out from NATO already. They've got one Bakan, one Caesar, and they seem to bring out another Caesar. So they've got pretty good artillery right now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, those Caesars are really nice artillery pieces. Very, very accurate. They can just pinpoint accuracy on enemy units. So they're going to be bringing out now artillery. Redfall, yeah, not really bringing out any RT whatsoever.
Tell me this, is the RBS-70, is it all NATO available, or is it faction-specific?
I believe that's all NATO available. The RBS-90's prototype run.
The 56 and the 90, I think, are prototype, but not the 70.
Yeah, the 90 run is a prototype because it has 2,800-meter range for a manpad, which is extremely bleeding long, and it's a very nice manpad.
So yeah, that sounds pretty good. 2,800.
Yeah, it's like that's most cannon AA and some missile AA have that range, so pretty powerful for a small little manpad. We have another tank push from NATO, Garrett or Blue Fork, going along the Foxtrot Valley. We have an M1A, 2 Abrams, some Scorpion light tanks and LAVs, and we'll be trying to break through the Redfall defensive line.
I'm liking the camo for the M1A2. That looks pretty good.
Oh yeah, it looks bloody fabulous. It's like a temperate forest camo.
It was interesting, someone on the forums pointed out, why does the Marder 1A3 have digital camouflage? nowhere in any kind of records has a Marder ever had digital camouflage, and they're like, it just looks good. We want to make it look different.
Next thing you know, with a pink Hello Kitty T90.
Why not?
Please make it happen, Eugene.
And then, like, give it, like, poor visibility or poor stealth.
Mm-hmm. But high armor resistance, of course.
And high morale, really.
And high morale, yeah. It never goes below worried. So we have this tank push. It's actually making quite a bit of progress, actually. M1A to Abrams and Saradin leading the raid. There's a bit of back and forth. It is going to be sort of hard to try and break his Redfall line because they have a spawn point right in Echo, and that leads, and that's very close to Foxtrot. And as you see, they're just churning out the tanks now.
And you know, Nata's pushing up with Scorpions and stuff and trying to waste their ammo. I think it'd be a better idea if they got some smoke and just cut off their line of sight. And then getting close with a bunch of cheap units and cheap infantry, and then keep your tanks in the rear. If you notice, one of these Abrams is breaking off. In just south of Foxtrot, and that's a good position to be around. I mean, you got to go around your enemy rather than keep trying to fighting it, you know, from the front.
Yeah, because you keep hitting your head against that roller of a defensive line, they're just gonna build their roll bigger and bigger. And as you can see, they're just getting a lot of bleeding tanks now. Those T-64 BVIs and T-72 BIs you don't really want to be in a receiving end of their cannon.
And in a lot of places, you see a lot of units are clumped up. They might not do so poorly with some cluster bomb MLRS. Not that I've put MLRS in my deck in a very long time, but I've heard good things about the cluster bomb MLRS.
Yeah, it's pretty inaccurate, but when it does get a hit, it does do a lot of damage, and it's a very popular unit for just sniping at enemy CVs. Because if it's a vehicle CV, especially if it's a jeep, run, hit, and the bugger's gone.
It's a very interesting mix of units from Jack Spartan. I mean, he's got Sheridans, MPT-70s, and Abrams. I don't quite understand that.
He's playing a full American deck, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah. And if you notice, Master Cybertron, he's bringing a lot of LAVs.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of LAVs, a lot with Bushmasters. And in those situations, I think Smoke would do him even better.
Yeah, because they are very fast. They have a pretty weak cannon, but if they can get up and close, those AS-LAVs run with the Bushmaster will do a bit of damage. But in
Pact has a good counter. I mean, I was just going to say that Pact has a bunch of T-72s there, and if there's one thing you could do well with Smoke is T-72s, because you get in close range and they got great AP.
So it's just going to be really hard to try and break his Foxtrot defensive rule. But where else can they attack? This is sort of a hard map to really push anywhere else, to be entirely honest. You have that river that goes straight down through the middle, right through the chest of the map, and you have to cross a bridge, and bridges are kind of annoying to deal with.
I think the solution in many of these situations is to have either very low point or a much higher point command zones outside, and much lower points in the center, and force the fighting away from the center, because it creates this sort of no man's land, which everyone just follows naturally. If you look, they're only really pushing in the north. That's where both sides are spending the units, and they're bulking up south. I mean, Pack can do so because they've taken Bravo, but NATO has not pushed once on Bravo.
Yeah, and they're just kind of keeping their little defensive line on the end. And neither side really wants to move up through Bravo or Gove, because if you're looking between them, that's a pretty big no-man-land area where you're just going to get sniped by an awful lot of ATGMs.
It's a massive kill zone, and the only way you're going to break a kill zone like that is with Smoke. It's literally, I can't think of another way.
Yeah. Smoke is your best friend.
That is a lot of artillery. That's two Bacans, two Caesars, and three AUF.
They made us break the Redfall front line of all the bleeding artillery they have. And as you said before, they could actually do quite a bit of smoking with that.
I don't understand Jack Spartan's choices. He's going for such a strange mix of tanks. I mean, he's just brought on another M1A2 and two Super M60s.
He's playing America. They don't have... America's cheap-end tanks aren't entirely great. They're more glass cannons, or, pretty...
I just don't... When I think of the Super M60, I don't really see much of the point of it. I wouldn't get a Super M60.
It's
I would
a pretty
get
good
a
tank.
Bunch of Patton Risers.
It's a
if
pretty,
you're going to go cheap.
It's a pretty good tank. It has a decent frontal armor and a pretty decent gun for 75 points. It's a slightly cheaper version of the M11P Abrams. And it looks, if you look at it, just take an up close look at it, it looks pretty badass. Looks something
it reminds
like
me.
A sci-fi movie, to be honest.
It reminds me of that Mexus, the Canadian tank.
The CT.
Side plating.
Yeah, because it has side plating all around it. It's a pretty decent tank. But in this open range Foxtrot thing, it's all about armor, baby. It's all about armor. And there's not really too much NATO stuff here that really has armor.
I really wish someone would bring on some smoke. I think smoke could be really useful. like, you know, the really cheap mortars that aren't particularly don't have particularly high HE, you can get huge numbers of them per card, and you just get one card of them, and that's all the mortar you'll ever need. And in some places, like the American mortar, the cheap one, which is 25 points, it has 120 ammo. You literally never have to reload these things because they always have ammo.
Yeah, mortars, I always think you always want mortars in your deck. No matter what deck it is, have mortars because they're great and instant fire support for smoking and stunning enemy targets. As you can see, Red Forex using their known as a great effect to pick off these very weakly armored chaparrals. And that's going to be an expensive loss.
They have very high HE, Nonas. I'd say the only issue for my choice with Nonas is that I feel they run out of ammo too quick. So if you're gonna use your ammo to shoot smoke rounds, it's kind of not cost effective.
Yeah, and they're pretty expensive, like 50 points per Nona. Yeah. That's quite a lot of money. Double in a normal mortar unit or a cheap mortar unit. But it really does bring its bang for its buck.
Yeah, NATO's really bulking up, but I'm not sure if they've got a plan, or it's pretty much just single file line down a road, first man dies, and then you continue onwards.
Yeah, it's just a lot of tanks in. I think that LAVs, if they all just move up with what they have right now, the LAVs are going to be the meat shields, and then the Abrams and Sheridans and Super M60s all behind are going to be trying to do all the killing. But yeah, it's a pretty large tank force here, but it's a very weakly armored tank force. And
I think BACT has some good, pretty good counters, though. I mean, if you notice in the south near Delta, they've got the helicopter Derp Patrol, which is a bunch of MIA-8s that are probably going to stun all those tanks, and they've got one Urgan, which is going to do pretty well against them.
Oh, yeah.
If they can time it right.
Red 4 is ready. Red 4 knows they're going to push. They know they're going to push through here. They don't know Ren, but they have all the units here to try and stop any shenanigans that goes on. And I bet you when Blue 4 moves up their tanks, there's going to be a bunch of planes coming out to bomb the everlasting crap out of him.
They do pretty well with the Bertino. The problem with Bertino is that they fire pretty slow. I mean, they aim really slowly, so you could have one or two things. You could either one, block their line of approach through that little position up north of Foxtrot, or you could fire it after they've come forward and then block any reinforcements that come through. So then it's pretty much just a kill box, and everything that comes forward is going to die and won't be able to retreat.
And also has a very short range of 3,500 meters, which is very pathetic for an artillery piece. But but it's a pretty big thing, and it shoots napalm rounds. So anything that shoots fire, I can't complain.
I'm noticing some Emro and some other fire support squads. How have you been finding fire support squads in the game so far?
I think really bleeding good. Ever since they gave fire support squads HE damage so they can fire onto infantry, they're a really good alternative to using flamethrower guys, because they are just great at blowing up tanks and blowing up infantry with their rocket launchers. And also...
I mean... Oh, go ahead.
No, ladies first.
Oh, low blow, man, low blow.
I'm joking. Now,
I was going to say, I remember in Airline Battle, that last patch when they brought out the small for Americans, I was quite disappointed that the small didn't have HE. That's something corrected, I believe.
Yeah, now I do, and the small squad is a very nice unit to have. Also, I'd like to note, they're using smoke, man, they're using smoke.
You know what would make me really happy is if you notice just in between Delta and Foxtrot, there's that little open space.
Oh, yeah.
If they could cut through there, they could go straight into the enemy back lines and kill all that artillery. That would be so sweet.
Oh, yeah.
Because there's literally nothing defending that.
Yeah, just the Nonas. They can even just get the Nonas, yeah. Just a quick LAV force up, yeah. Or a bit of recon. Try and do a bit of damage.
And then, I mean... That road is so straight, you could pretty much send one command vehicle, like a command tank, straight down the center. I mean, the only thing they've got defending it is a BMP and a LAV. I mean, sorry, it's two LAVs. That's it. They got nothing else as long range that can stop them.
I see. But they're probably all just focused up into Foxtrot at the moment. And speaking of Foxtrot, the SOTA's going out, but he's fast moving his units.
Why?
Oh, it's just going to be a conga line of death.
True, but he's sending in his scorpions first, so that might not be a bad thing.
But they're going to block up the road.
Oh, yaks. Oh, my God, the yaks.
Yo, the yaks. Oh, yakety sack. Oh, blimey. That's why you don't fast move when you attack, ladies and gentlemen.
True, single file line, man. What did I say? Yeah. Single file line.
Single file line. I thought he would at least stretch him out, but nope.
Oh, and he's using the napalm.
Yeah,
I thought he might use napalm. Mm-hmm.
Blocking off line, blocking off their pathway. I told you they're going to be using the planes once Bluefall moves up. They were ready for this. But luckily, Bluefall's killer tanks, the Abrams and the Super M60 and MBTs, they're all still alive, and they're going to be able to fire back and dish out some damage. Though I don't think his assault will work. NATO may be able to just get a little bit of ground and, heck, maybe kill some enemy units.
If you noticed, NATO's also smoked the town, but they just don't have enough infantry. Just not enough infantry.
There's a lot of mods directly in there, and also just outside of it, you have all the bleeding tanks. And there were a few helicopters before, you know, to stop him. But yes, you're right, they needed more infantry to make it infantry, so it happened, because that was hardly enough. And a few governments and, like, one Foutshaker squad.
I think NATO might be in a very dangerous position now. Mm-hmm. If this fails, the counterattack could be swift, and they'd have nothing to stop them. Apart from mortars and anti-air vehicles. Perfect counters to tanks.
NATO at the bottom of Fox, at the bottom edge of Fox, has some Enrors in the forest. He's going to be going around the forest line. He could probably pick off the CV and all the AA gits inside.
True, that's a good unit. He just needs to be aggressive with it.
Yeah, I think he's just camping him out at the moment. He could at least neutralize Foxtrot and get in a plus one. They do have the bottom part of that.
Oh, the Abrams are almost dead. That's some good cluster bombs.
Mm-hmm. Great cluster bombs. You don't really see plain cluster bombs anymore.
I've not been using them.
I don't use them either. I don't know why. I just prefer to use iron bombs now because they're more universal. I find myself wanting to blow up enemy AA positions and infantry more than enemy tank columns. That's why I keep using iron bombs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Where an ally in battle, you'd always have at least some sort of cluster bomber, because the bloody Leopard 2A4s and T-80s were a pain in the butt to deal with.
True, I mean, in those situations, I mean, I didn't actually ever rely on air cluster bombs, even in ally in battle. I just sort of preferred a lot of super Etonauts.
Mm. Oh yeah, ATGM planes, of course.
That was another huge, I mean, talk about like game-changing things. I remember the patch that completely changed ATGM planes. And then everyone started using Thunderbolts afterwards.
just ATGM planes are also pretty good in a Red Dragon now, because it's a lot of open terrain. You can see your enemy, and you can keep line of sight on the enemy. ATGM plane comes in, knocks out your Leclerc.
The other day I tried using one of those rocket planes against a ship. Didn't turn out so well. just trying. I wish they did more damage.
I believe that napalm planes work pretty well against ships, because you at least stun them up a bit. It's kind of like a flying Greek fire ship. That's what I like to think of napalm planes now.
Yeah, Pact is handled this pretty well. They may have their point nooched, but it doesn't really matter because they can already see it and they're going to drop bombs on that very soon. They've got to flee on it.
I do like what Bluefall are doing. It's a bit unnecessary, but they're doing the WTF tactic of smoking their own CV, making it completely obvious where it is, but you can't get line of sight. I always love it when they do that, because it's such a double-bladed sword, a double-edged sword.
True. Except for the fact it won't stop napalm.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of napalm, they actually have a really nice napalm, just bloody cluster in between that little valley, and those tanks are going through and they're getting stunned.
I mean, they've got more units coming up, reinforcements. This is going to be their third or second push now on Foxtrot. Mm-hmm. I just don't see it happening. Like, this is drip feeding the enemy. They need to have a more concerted push somewhere other than just the front.
But they don't need to completely control Foxtrot. If they just at least have it neutralized or just knock out the enemy CV. You see right now, because they killed the enemy CV or not moved it in Foxtrot, they're gaining a plus 3 advantage. So if they can at least just keep knocking out that BMP run command vehicle, they can at least try and catch up to the point.
Yeah, and I think he's got that idea because he's starting to move up his MROs. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't mind if you put on top of that mountain some recon infantry, some specialized recon infantry.
And even some manpads as well to shoot down those pesky planes that Redfall has an awful lot of. But yeah, just going across that, going through that valley constantly, as you said, it's going to be the end of them, because Redfall knows they're going to come through here. They're just going to keep napalming that little choke point over and over and over again, not allowing NATO to move up.
And just so you know, the most powerful unit on the battlefield has just arrived, the SU-122.
Oh god, that's all, everyone ducking cover, SU-122 is on the field.
I can't physically put those units in my deck. I just can't. Just the idea of putting T-80Us and SU-122s in the same deck, just, I can't do it. It's a step I won't take in terms of min-maxing. Mm-hmm. There's some lines you draw in Red Dragon.
Everyone has their standards. And those are your standards. No SUs.
I won't min-max to that extent. That's interesting, he's using a lot of T-62s. I mean, I don't like T-62s at all. I think they're a pretty crappy line of tanks. Apart from the fact that cheap ATGMs.
Yeah. They're pretty the cheaper ones, I do enjoy the cheap T-62s because they have horrible fuel autonomy and they're slow as crap, which is the bad thing about them. But if you look at their gun's pretty good for the price and they have decent frontal armor. I like to think of it as a slightly better T-55, just because it's slightly better, it has worse fuel and speed.
They remind me of Jagdpanzers, or like tank destroyers. They're just designed to just stay in one position and defend.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really kind of a goal of a T-62. It's a very defensive tank because of its speed. But its gun, as I mentioned before, it's pretty decent. And also the ATGMs on later runs.
Yeah, the high-end ones have pretty good ATGMs for the price.
Mm-hmm. Those SUs, those fearful SU-122-54s, holding the choke point.
The helicopter dirt patrols here.
Oh god!
God save the queen.
That's a lot of MIH.
That is a lot of rockets. I wish this game had a night option. I'd love to see all the rockets exploding at night. Mm-hmm. All the fire trails. What do they call them?
Tracers.
Yeah, I'd love to see all the tracers. That'd be so good.
Mm-hmm.
There was a nighttime map in European Escalation, I remember.
Yeah, it was I know what you're talking about. I've forgotten the bloody name of it though.
It was one of those tournament looking maps, you know, with like asymmetric sides and
stuff.
Oh
yeah, yeah.
With the rivers.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I just don't remember the bleeding map.
Yeah.
Seems like his helicopter shot in mid is not really going too well. There's all those hinds and MIAs, they're actually getting artillery, which is a little bit odd.
They did pretty well though, they're pretty much next to no anti-air there, and the anti-air that is there is out of rockets.
Yeah, so they are going to survive, but they're not doing too much damage, and now they're just pulling back those hinds and MIH, going to rearm and refuel, and save it for another day.
It's interesting, two command vehicles coming up to Foxtrot. I wonder what his plan is.
Oh yeah, I see. The two P4s, PCs.
I'd like to send these players a message that they don't have to play in 1/8 of the map, that the rest of the map is available.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's even just a bit of recon around the other side, just to poke, just to see what chair would be a good idea. But they are committed on that top part.
You know, that's why when I play sometimes, right, and then I'll be pushing because I like to push, and then other people will join me, and I'm like, no, don't join me. Don't send troops to try and help me. Because if
How
you do
dare
that,
you help me?
No, because if you send troops to help me, then that becomes the focus of our game, and you're all surrounded by one area, and then the enemy will respond by putting way more forces on this side as well, and it just turns from what it should have been like a quick strike into maybe make a World War One reference, but can't think of anything right now.
Like a hit and run?
Oh, I was gonna say like the. I can't think of anything. Name a World War One battle on the.
Ypres, Somme.
Yes, I was gonna say Somme. It turns it from a strict quick strike into the Somme, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Don't stay away from me. Don't give me troops. I'll handle myself.
Yes.
Keep me alone.
How dare you? How dare you be on my team and help me out with your forces? I absolutely hate this. This is a 1v1 match between this and this, me and this guy. Don't you dare send me anything to help. Not even planes or resupply. Nothing.
Yeah, get this.
the audacity of some people, right?
Because you noticed it, right? Like, sometimes you'd be pushing and you'd be doing well and you'd be making grab. And then they send you help. And because they send you help, the enemy sort of notices it and they start to reposition themselves. And then what should have been a very straightforward attack turns into basically it turns into the Somme.
Yeah, and it just turns into the center point of battle where both sides are just pushing back and forth between that run area, which is sort of happening at the moment.
Oh my god. You know when they're bringing out harpoons, they run out of ideas.
Oh, the harpoons are great close-range tanks, but I wouldn't call this a close-range engagement.
No, no, absolutely not. And they die so easily.
Yeah. Two frontal armor, or two... What was it? Three frontal armor. It's very low frontal armor. It's really going to protect them from the T-72s and Shon Onmar Hor 4.
That's an interesting tank. Good AP.
Yeah, it's a Chinese one, isn't it?
North Korean.
It's North Korean one, okay. Yeah, it seems like the Red Dragons, all their tanks are very glass cannony. They all have good guns, but they only have mediocre to rubbish armor.
God, I love the T-72 tank line. It's nothing quite like it. So versatile.
Yeah, they really made it a lot better in this game thanks to like the T-90 versions of the T-72. Because you got the super expensive ones, like the Optra 1989, which is completely phenomenal, and it's a good rifle to a good alternative to getting the T80 line of tanks.
And some of it is so ephemeral. Like the idea, like one of the things I love about T-72s is just they have great autonomy. You can keep them on the field for a long time without having to worry about fuel. Whereas you use something like the Abrams has 5 less ammo than the Leopard 2, right? The Leopard 2A4. Mm-hmm. But you notice that because you feel like you have to resupply it a lot more often. And you feel like they run out of fuel so often. It's like, whereas the T-72 is just on the field all the time. It's such a good feeling.
Yeah, T-72 is a very just... It's just a frontline tank. It's designed for frontline battles.
I'm into something right now. I'm doing something.
You a bit busy?
Yeah, I was just doing something. I think I got distracted.
Okay. Oh, that's fine. Yeah, a bit of ATGM playing back and forth. T-72 BIs getting knocked out in Foxtrot. And at the bottom of Foxtrot, a bunch of Emeralds moving up with like, oh, Gustavs. And they're going to be trying to get a little bit of a ground. Going to bloody hell. A bit of a foothold into the south of Foxtrot. Try to at least neutralize it. But there's 5 minutes left on the clock. There's 400 points or 300 points in 5 minutes.
Oh, yeah. If you look at that, there's actually a couple of Havocs on the field in Echo. I want him to move those up.
Echo. Yeah, you don't really see MI-28 being used too much anymore. People just prefer to use Kula because it has...
Me too.
It has a better ATGM and it has AA, so it's a lot more versatile where the Havoc is just for killing tanks and infantry targets, where the Kula can just bloody do anything.
If you mix the Akula with the Recon Akula, it's pretty damn awesome.
Doing just an assault with like two normal Akulas and then a Recon Akula with some Hinge in the back. It is just a pure recipe for disaster for the enemy.
I mix them up with the T-90s and you just get like a really killer combo. Mm-hmm. Super heavy micro, but very satisfying when it works.
They're just Russian helicopters. You do not mess with Russian helicopters. Even the Hind, it's still an amazing piece of kit.
I kind of wish this game had like a paint editor where you could just make your own camos and stuff. Mm-hmm.
Hello Kitty cool. camo.
Oh yeah.
I'd pay $2 for you.
Don't you just cover your units with like little smaller pictures of themselves. Abrams have Abrams painted on them, and those Abrams have Abrams painted on. It just goes back and forth.
It just goes on and on and on. An infinite loop of Abrams. There's a certain word for that, but I don't know the word at the moment.
I'm sure it's French.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of those fancy words are French. Bloody hell, if you look at the left side of Foxtrot, that's a huge bunch of MI6s landing in. That's like a FOB supply worth of helicopters.
They're pretty good. I stopped using the MI. What is it? The MI-28?
The MI-26, the big 26. FOB one.
Yeah, stop using them. MI-6 is pretty good.
Yeah, MI-6 is a nice mix or a nice alternative between the MI-8 resupply and the MI-26. As the MI-26 gave you just way too much, and it was a big bullseye shoot me. Well, the MI-8 didn't carry too much. And the MI-6, a nice mix between both of them.
Very and nice, you know, if I'm being honest, I've almost completely stopped using supply trucks. I have almost completely transitioned entirely towards supply choppers because it's so much faster.
That's very different for me. I prefer using supply trucks because I'm really paranoid of enemy AA, and how is a lot of good anti-helicopter AA now, and I'm always right close to the front lines. I'm very paranoid of landing my helicopters because I think they're going to get shot at by a nasty Roland in the ridge.
Ah, yeah. I mean, usually I keep my tanks, like, I'll have secure places that I go into the back line behind my infantry to supply, but I don't tend to supply while fighting. Maybe that's the difference.
I do, yeah. It's like having a cup of tea while showing them firing a machine gun. And I think, unless Blue Fork can just nuke all the enemy's CV's points right now in 2 minutes and 25 seconds, I highly doubt they can bring us back. Or this is going to be bloody impossible.
They brought in three STRVs, so game's won basically now for NATO.
Yeah. They have actually managed to... they did have Foxtrot neutralized for brief seconds, but some planes had to fly over and ruin their day. Bit of artillery back and forth. Just trying to stun the TATs and all that rubbish.
I think NATO could have done well with some Skyhawks, some kind of rocket planes.
Or trying to move down at least a different flank, because if they, at least, even though the middle part of the map, it's bridges, and bridges are nasty, all the Red 4 have a pretty lightly defended, like Delta, for example, if you just do one quicker shot over into Delta, try to gain some ground and hold it out, it would be a lot better than just hitting yourself against this ATTM rule that Red 4 has set up.
If you look south at Gulf, right, all they needed was to use their helicopter dev patrol, and all they had to face them was one Veek 40, and that's it.
Yeah, Red 4 could
have... 70 as well.
Yeah. I think both sides, they were just so caught up in the middle, that's all they were doing, they're spending points on middle, because you kind of... It's very easy to get tunnel vision in this game, to be entirely honest. Very easy to just be focused on one point and just wanting to get that point. And both sides really suffered from that tunnel vision.
It's not even really in the middle when you think about it.
Yeah, I would admit, it's sort of a hard map to move up, though, because of that river down the middle and the bridges. And because of this, like, goddamn ATGM hell between Foxtrot. And we have this one final hurrah, Scorpions and Saradins, all really lightly armored tanks. And they're gonna get blown up through the gun. Got some nice ATGMs, got the T-80, and there here comes the MiG, dropping clusters.
And Pact have it.
Yeah, and Red 4 do bring in the good game during an actual time victory. Pretty long match that was, going all the way to the time limit.
That's an alright game.
Yeah, Red 4 getting the KD advantage by over 2,000, pretty obvious as they were doing the defense that entire time. And yeah, pretty good match.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of good tactics on both sides and a lot of bad tactics on both sides.
Yeah.
But I think the good tactics sort of showed off some of the better parts of the game, being smoke, being how to use planes, how to attack en masse, but I think at the same time, there's a lot of bad tactics, you know.
Yeah.
Not attacking from multiple positions, focusing on one side of the map only.
Conga being too lines. Reliant.
Yeah, conga lines, and being too reliant, I think, on certain types of units.
Yeah, like,
Go ahead.
I think the tunnel vision really just bleeding killed both teams, because that could have been over a lot faster if Redfall or Bluefall just moved up on either side of the bottom part of the map. Because that was... pretty much left
Yeah, I mean, like,
unfocused on.
They could have just put a couple of units and some fast IVs and send them down the center and just see what happened, you know? Just, yeah. Or just some recon, anything.
Mm-hmm, just,
but they didn't.
Test out the waters, test out their defenses, but well, both sides just try to defend the middle or the top part of the map, and it's just back and forth ATGM rule. And, yeah, I guess that's all we have time for. I'm Mangru.
And I'm Sidoz.
Take it easy.